Okay, in today's video, we're going to talk about calibration frames, your darks and your flats. I'm going to show you what they are, why they're important, and how you make them. I'm John Robinson, the Astrotard, and you're watching the Deep Sky Channel. So, calibration frames, what are they? In astrophotography, when we point our telescope at an object for a long period of time and take hundreds or thousands of photos, we're going to have some anomalies and noise that builds up in our images. And the calibration frames are a way of handling that anomaly and that noise. So I'm going to talk about three types of calibration frames today. The first one is the bias, and it's maybe the easiest one. The bias calibration is simply a way of capturing the read noise that's inherent within every camera. And the way to capture those is you put your lens cap on top of your imaging train, decrease your exposure time to the shortest possible, and take some pictures. Integrate those together and that becomes your bias, which represents the read noise within your camera. Then we come to dark frames. So dark frames are a way of taking a picture of the hot pixels that are residing inside of your imaging session. So again, putting the lens cap on top of the imaging train and then matching the camera's temperature, camera's focus, and camera's exposure time to those of the light frames, then we're able to capture that those hot pixels that are showing up in those in our lights and then later subtracting them out. Finally, there's flat frames. So flat frames need to be taken for each of the filters that are run in your imaging train if you're running with a mono camera. And a flat frame is essentially taking a picture of those little dust bunnies that are going to attach themselves to the surfaces wherever you have glass in your imaging train, whether that be on the telescope lens or on the filters or maybe on the camera sensor itself. These little dust bunnies will attach themselves. So we're going to take a picture of that by putting a constant light source in front of the imaging session and then taking a picture of it, not having to worry so much about the temperature, but we do have to care about the gain and we do have to care about the focus, and we also have to care about something called ADU. So an ADU is a conversion of the number of electron volts that the image sensor has measured. So it's a conversion from zero to maximum, and the maximum will differ depending on the camera. But basically what it's saying is, with zero, I'm capturing zero photons. With maximum, I'm capturing complete saturation of photons. So what we want to do in a flat frame is choose an ADU, which is between 50 and 33% of the maximum total possible within that camera. Let's take a look at what an image would look like without calibration and what it would look like with calibration. And then we'll also show you how to take those calibration frames. Here's an example of the M16 Eagle Nebula, and I'm showing you several photos up here. Up here in the upper left, this is H alpha with no calibration frames, no flat, no dark, no bias. It's pretty good data to begin with, but you can see there's some anomalies in here. You can see up here, I've got some dead pixels that are showing up, and although it's hard to see it in this photo, there's actually some vignetting in the corners that's going on here. Then next to it, I've got three examples. I've got an example with H-alpha with bias, darks, and flats. But in this case, the flat was taken with zero gain. Here's an example of what that zero gain integrated flat file looks like. Here's the same thing with a flat that was taken at 75 gain. Here's what the 75 gain flat looked like. Here's where you can begin to see the dust bunnies and the dark pixels showing up in there. And then here's H alpha captured with the gain set for flat at 139. It's almost identical to 75.
But it actually does a better job, I think, overall, as I'll show you in a minute, of getting rid of the anomalies. So the lesson here is, especially for narrow band, you don't want to use a zero gain setting for your flats. You probably want to use somewhere between 75 or 139, at least for the camera that I'm using. Let's take a look now. If we compare the uncalibrated image with the perfectly calibrated image with the gain setting of 139, the best example. Put them side by side. You can see that it got rid of those ugly dark patches there. You can also see that some of the vignetting has gone away. Hopefully that gives you a sense of what calibration frames can do for you. It definitely cleans up your images. And when you're all done, they look pretty sweet. Okay. Yeah, so here's an example of the completed image that's about 15 hours of integration time. This is using the 75G flat. And if I were to do this again, I'd probably try it again with 139G flat. But I'm pretty happy with this image. It looks really crisp. You don't see a lot of anomalies in this thing. They're all pretty clean around the edges. You know, and I feel like I've got more data and less noise in this image. If we zoom in down here, you can see the pillars of creation nice and crisp and clear. And you don't see any of those little dust bunnies either. So let's remind ourselves of those dust bunnies, what they look like. So those little dust bunnies that would appear up there in the right corner are not visible in this image here. Whereas if we look at back at this image, you can kind of see that they're in there.
All right, now let me show you how to capture those calibration frames. So today I'm going to show you how to do flats and calibration. There's several ways to do it. I've got my setup here in the house today. The old tried and true method is to hang a t-shirt over the front of your lens and then point it at a clear patch of the sky. And I used to do that successfully for a while, but I've since upgraded. So I now have a drawing tablet that I shine inside of the lens and I take my calibration that way. So I'm gonna start this session by rotating this 90 degrees so it's pointing straight up. We've got this thing rotated in the 90 degree direction, straight pointing straight up. Here's my drawing pad right here and I've just got two sheets of paper. It needs to be clean paper. And I'm just gonna go ahead and place this on top of the unit like this. Now be sure when you do that, that you turn this up all the way so that you're consistently using the same luminosity. In my case, I've got three settings on there and I like to use the brightest setting. There's the unit with the drawing pad on top of it. And you can see here that one thing I want to point out is make sure you've got enough room to do this. In my case, this is why I have a pier extension on my mount, so that I have enough clearance for the camera when it comes down with no problem. Without the pier extension, I run the risk of running into that leg. Believe me, I've seen that before.
I guess the most important thing to know about flats is you want to take the flats with the imaging train untouched from your last imaging session. And that's important. Okay, so this target list will be blown away when I go through the calibration. So we'll go up here in Sequence Generator Pro, Tools, Flats Calibration Wizard. Okay, so let's go ahead and choose the APO0, the one I just created. And then what I'm going to do here is select for each of the different seven filters that I have which binning level I want to do a calibration against. In my case, I only ever capture images in 1x1 binning. And so that's what we'll do here in this flats calibration. So what this calibration wizard is going to do is essentially determine what is the optimum exposure time to reach a target mean ADU. As I mentioned earlier, my camera, the 1600 Mono, has a range of 0 to 65,000 ADUs. So I'm going to be looking to hit a 30K ADU within a tolerance of plus or minus 100. I use a tight tolerance because I'm using that drawing panel, which is a constant light source. I'm not worried about clouds or anything going over it. It's going to be a constant light source, so I can afford to be very tight in my tolerance. I'm not going to worry about maximum exposures. When I press start here, what it's going to do is set the filter, and then for each filter, it's going to make some measurements based on an exposure time or what the mean ADU is in the histogram. And you can sort of see that up here in the upper left here. It's going to show you the histogram for each one of these. If it's super exposed, 65K, there's the max ADUs for this thing at 1 second. So here's the test of that zero gain that I talked about. I want to avoid a 0.02 exposure time. I want to be above that. It looks like I'm 0.06 for 30K. So 0.06 seconds was about right for my loom, which is fine. So I'm going to let this thing run. I will come back after this completes.
A few moments later.
Okay, this has finished its calibration setting. So I'm going to save this. What that's going to do is apply a time setting for each of the filters here. So let's go ahead and stretch this out. And here's the seven filters. And I'm going to go ahead and mark run for each of these. Now, this is a minor complaint with Sequence Generator Pro. I just ran the flats calibration wizard. Why do I have to select flats on all these things? It knows that that's what I'm trying to run, but okay. Minor gripe. Otherwise, I really do like Sequence Generator Pro. Okay, we got some run set, we got flat set. As soon as I choose the filter here, you can see the exposure time shows up there. We'll do that for each one of these. And then I like to do at least 50 calibration frames for integration. So we'll put 50 for each one of those. I also like to let them finish the entire filter before it goes on to the next filter. So I'm going to go ahead and let that run. Again, checking my settings here. So the camera temperature is 4.5. I don't care about temperature. The gain setting I do care about is 0. So I think we're good to go. Let's go ahead and get this thing started. And you can sort of see, I guess what I want to show you here is maybe we'll take a couple of these loom captures and I'll show you what this is looking like. No, I don't care about the temperature. So yes, proceed. And we'll go ahead and save those in the default directory. In my case, it's in the master 2 file. That's where I'm saving those. Okay, so now it's going to go ahead and capture these. What I should be noticing here, this is my loom, is you begin to see, maybe it's hard to see here, some of the dust mites that are showing up here. And if I tilt the camera, yeah, you can see them over here on the right. You can see all these little dust motes that are showing up. Essentially, the flats are going to, when I integrate those 50 flats, I'll have a master flat, and it'll be able to inform my PixInsight how to remove those dust motes from the picture. So now you get a kind of sense of how to create the flats. I'll come back when these are done, and we'll do an integration. Okay, so we've finished with the flats capture. Now we're going to go ahead and do some darks and bias. So I'm going to go ahead and move this panel off of this thing here. And we'll replace that with the actual lens cap, which I have just sitting right here. And I'm also going to cover that, if I can do this with one hand. I'm also going to cover that with a towel or something. I'm going to go ahead and cover this with a towel, just one level more protection, I guess. So now we're gonna do our darks and our bias. So the thing about darks, it's important that you take them with the same gain and the same camera temperature that you used for the capture. It's not so important to do that for the flats, but for darks, it really is important. So in this case, I've captured at a negative 18 degrees and my temperature is set to that. My gain is at 139, and that's what I use to capture the light. All right, so these ones are going to be, I'm going to have, now darks are all captured with loom, but I want to capture a different range of exposures. My minimum exposure is 30 seconds. I don't have very many of those. I have a few once in a while. Sometimes I capture in 1 minute intervals, sometimes 2 minute intervals. Most of the time, especially narrow band, I'm at 5 minutes. So that's my range for the darks that I want to capture today. And those are all going to be with the loom setting, loom filter. Now the bias is a little bit different because the bias, again, with a lume filter, is the absolute minimum exposure time. And it in Sequence Generator Pro, it defaults to 0 second exposure, which basically just flashes the camera as fast as it can. And that's good enough for a bias. So again, I'm going to do the same 50 here for each one of these. Now, these are going to take a long time. You can imagine 5 minutes times 50 exposures. This will take you quite a bit of time to run these. So relax. Also, I'm going to do a finish the entire thing and let it run through. So let's go ahead and create these now. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different darks and one bias. All at gain 139 and temperature minus 18. All right, I'll be back when these are done. Okay, we've just completed our flats, darks, and our bias image captures. Now it's time to do an image integration on all of those. I won't do all of them for the sake of time, but I will show you initially how to do one if it's not obvious to you already. So I've launched PixInsight here. We're going to process image integration, or you could double click on the little shortcut that I've created right there. And I'll go ahead and add the files, and I'll browse to them out there on the master. So there's bias, darks, and flats. We'll go ahead and start with the flats here. And I'm going to select all of these lume frames that I created. We'll add those in there. And then I'm not going to play with any of the other settings. I'm just going to integrate them as it is and watch that thing go.
A few moments later.
File finished processing, and we don't need the rejection low. We just need the integrated image here. We'll stretch that, and here's what it looks like. So you can see, in this case, I'm using a gain 139 lume flat. Now, for lume, I don't really like the gain 139. I'll probably prefer the gain 0. I get better results from it when I do. For lume, I use 0. Red, green, blue, I use 75. And for the narrowband, I use 139. Anyway, but I wanted to show it to you, what it looks like here. And you just do a save as, in my case. Save it to the master file here. This is a dark lume. Sorry, a flat lume, 30K, 139G. I've already saved the file, so right there. You can find it right there. So that's exactly how you do the image integration. You may have your own way. You could use Deep Sky Stacker as well. I prefer PixInsight.
Let's recap. So calibration frames. So flats, these are for your dust bunnies and for the vignetting that's around the outside of your images. You should use a constant light source when you capture these. You should use a 50% ADU setting when you're looking at the histogram. You should capture a flat for each of the filters that you have in your imaging tray. For the lume filter, I recommend a gain setting of 0. For the red, green, and blue, I recommend a gain setting of 75. And for the narrowband, I recommend a gain setting of 139. Those seem to be the optimal settings for my camera, the ZWO ASI 1600 Mono. You can run this at any camera temperature that you like, but the focus needs to match what you did in your light imaging session. Next are the darks. These are for your hot pixels. You capture these by putting the lens cap on and using the lume filter. It's very important that you match the focus, the gain, and the exposure time for those of your lights. Finally, your bias. This is for the basic read noise, which is inherent in every one of our cameras. You also capture this with the lens cap on, but the difference here is that your exposure time is the absolute minimum that your camera is capable. Just a quick flash and you're done. So hopefully that gives you an idea of what calibration frames are and how to create them. So if you found this interesting, click subscribe. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time. Bye.